WOLB Baltimore and WERQ FM HD3 Baltimore, celebrating Radio 1's 42nd anniversary.
Our Radio 1 family, our employees, their family members, our listeners, our viewers, our extended family.
And serving the African American community for over 42 years.
The views and opinions of the guest and host you hear on 1010 WOLB
are not necessarily those of the staff and management of Radio 1, its sponsors, or advertisers.
A boy is born in hot damn Mississippi, surrounded by for what that ain't so pretty. His parents give him love and affection to keep him strong, moving in the right direction, living just enough for the city. His father works some days for 14 hours, and you can bet he barely makes a dollar. His mother goes scrub the floors for many, and you best believe she hardly gets a penny. Living just enough for the city. Short, but Lord, her legs are sturdy. To walk to school, she's got to get up early. Her clothes are old, but never are they dirty. Living just enough for the city. Her brother's smart, he's got more sense than many. His patience long, but soon he won't have any. To find a job is like a haystack needle, 'cause where he lives, they don't use colored people. Living just enough for the city.
All right, we're back on the air. Second hour of the Frank M. Conaway Sr. et al. Show with co-host, attorney Tehma Smith Wilson.
Good morning, Baltimore. Thank you for joining us once again for this second hour. I'm an attorney and small business owner in Baltimore City. If you need to reach me during the show or after the show, I can be reached at 667-334-7242. 667-334-7242. And I wanted to let you know that the Brown Lecture Series, there will be a Brown Lecture Series sponsored by Mr. Eddie C. and Miss Sylvia Brown Foundation that will be held at the Enoch Pratt Library on Cathedral Street. This is going to be a lecture series that features Mr. Eric Holder, Attorney General Eric Holder. He wrote a book called Our Unfinished March, where he would provide a history of voting rights and weigh in on combating voter suppression. He will also be joined by the president of the University of Baltimore Law School, Mr. Kirk Smoke, former mayor of Baltimore City. If you're interested in attending this event, you will get a free copy of the book. It's on February the 8th from 7 to 8 o'clock, and you will get a parking voucher so you can come. The event is free. The parking is free. It's an hour lecture series, and you will get a book. You can go to the Enoch Pratt Library website to get your ticket, or you can text me, and I will send you the information about this lecture series.
All right. Now, when is that again and where?
February the 8th, 7 o'clock p.m. at the Enoch Pratt Library, 400 Cathedral Street, the main branch.
That's going to be interesting. Eric Holder and Kurt Smoke together?
Yeah. Together. Oh. Unfinished Business Lecture Series.
Okay. All right. All right. Okay. And our other co-host, Attorney Robert Bob Dashiell, the Dean.
Good morning. Still here, still mean, and still me. 410-547-8820.
And yours truly, Carlton C. Douglas of the Carlton C. Douglas Funeral Service, PA. If you need our services, the telephone number is 410-669-1738. And I do want to announce the passing and services arrangements of Mrs. Eleanor Jackson. Many of us knew her as Aunt Duck. 100 years young, bless her heart, will be on Tuesday. The viewing will begin at 10. The wake will begin at 11:30 with the services at 12 at 4600 Liberty Heights Avenue under the direction of Carlton C. Douglas Funeral Service, PA. And the interment to follow King Memorial Park. And that's Ms. Eleanor Jackson, better known to many as Aunt Duck. Those of you who belong to Gillis Memorial, she is the aunt of a very well-known member there, Mrs. Winifred Shug Parks. Okay. All right, we're coming back to the lines. I'm going to Bob, before we get in that discussion we was in, I'm gonna get these two folks here because they've been on for a while. So we're coming to Chuck, James, Robert. I believe this is either Sylvia or Sylvia, and Mark. Chuck, you're on air. Chuck, you're on air.
Yeah, good morning, lady and gentlemen.
Mm-hmm.
Good morning.
You know, one thing criminals don't give a rat's behind about, that's laws, legislation, and bills. You know what I mean? Because that's part why they're criminals. Now, as far as these guns, you know, they use this catchphrase, ghost guns. It ain't nothing but a catchphrase to distract your mind from thinking that the manufacturers are shipping in crates of these guns and they're not putting a stamp on them, nor a serial number. So now everybody been bought into the catchphrase of ghost guns. They think people are putting them together. You know, these half of these criminals can't have read and write, you know, and it's not that easy to assemble a weapon if you're not familiar with assembling weapons, you know, and that's what's going on with it, to keep you from going after the manufacturers that's really making them and shipping them in. You know, everybody's caught up on the catchphrase, ghost gun. And as far as a 3D printer, they showed you that a 3D printer has the ability to do this, but none of these cats got no access to no $300,000 printer and the schematic and the information to know how to do that. But that's just to keep your mind from looking at the manufacturers who are actually doing this stuff.
Well, hold it, Chuck. I can tell you right now, some friends of mine bought their twin sons a 3D printer for Christmas. It ain't cost no $300,000.
Right.
So can that one.
Right, and just because these folks engage in criminal activity, don't think they're stupid. I visited once Hagerstown, where it's the site of what used to be called State Use Industries. Now it's called Correctional Enterprise Program. But everybody in there, none of the prisons in there. In fact, very few of the prisons in there had high school diplomas or GEDs. But yet, on a daily basis, they operated, maintained, and repaired very expensive, very sophisticated equipment in manufacturing, meat processing, agriculture, and other and furniture manufacturing. So just because they have a criminal mindset and been caught and in prison doesn't mean they don't have the intelligence to be able to follow the instructions to put together using a 3D printer a so-called ghost gun. That you would be significantly and seriously underestimating the level of intelligence of our children and many of our children.
But because of supply and demand, and the demand is so high, the manufacturers are pushing these guns in.
The guns are not the problem. The guns are not the problem. It's the heart and mind and souls of the people. That's the problem.
And the culture.
You can sum it up in a word called culture. But if it's not guns, it would be knives. If it's not knives, it would be swords. If it's not swords, it would be pitchforks. It's going to be something. Okay.
They don't have the heart to use the knives because it takes face to face contact. They want to use the gun so they can stand back at a distance. That's why they shoot all the wrong people. Let me do a quick comment about the water bills.
Mm-hmm.
You know, with all the fees and taxes attached to it, it's actually more than the water bill. And they did it every 3 months because now they charge all the taxes and fees every month rather than doing it every 3 months like they used to. And the consumption flush tax actually was the flush tax, but they fought against the flush tax, so they stuck it in there, added it to the consumption tax. And then they had to use the word flush tax, and people just stopped fussing about it.
Thank you, Chuck. Appreciate you, man.
Thank you.
All right. Now let's go to James. James, you're on air. We got a line open, 410-481-1010, 410-481-1010. Go ahead, James.
Hey, how y'all doing this morning? I was calling because allegedly, from some sources that I know down in Memphis, they said that was a love triangle. They said that... that guy allegedly was messing with that cop's wife. Yeah, so they allegedly was hooking up on the side. So that's all alleged from some people that I know. Now, another thing I wanted to comment on, hey, we're going to have to do something about these water bills, man. These water bills are out of control. Like I said, this is throughout the whole United States. We're going to have to do something about these water bills. We're going to have to come together, pick it. I don't know, because... they live good with this water. But, yeah, that's all I just wanted to comment on. They saying that was a love triangle, so maybe more information to come out about it.
But, James.
You know?
James.
Yeah.
You have to agree, though, whether it was a love triangle or a quadruple triangle, ain't nowhere in the hell they should have beat that boy like they did.
Oh, yeah, I agree with you on
there
that.
There ain't no excuse. That love triangle.
He could have got a divorce. Yeah, just got the house, the car, and everything, and been on his merry way. But now he going up the river, and now she's going to get everything and go get herself another side piece.
You talk like it was one officer. It was five officers that participated in the beating, right? You know that, right?
Allegedly who started it. The officer that started it, he started it because that guy allegedly was having a relationship with his wife.
The other four just joined in for the heck of it.
Well, you know this, Bob, that it's police. One police that thin blue line. One police sees something, they're going to go on with the other police. And that's on them, you know?
I think it is what it is, but it's all in there.
All right, James.
All right.
Appreciate you, man.
Y'all have a good one.
Okay.
Yes, sir. I'll call next week.
All right. Bye. Line open, 410-481-1010, 410-481-1010. Let's go to Robert. Robert, you're on air.
Hey, good morning. How you doing?
Fine.
Hey, listen, man, I got something I've been thinking about since these classified documents. And I think the media's not going farther enough with the history of these documents and where they end up at. And this is my opinion. I believe each one of these officials who are in those cabinets, especially the White House, State Department, they're allowed to take these documents home, and these documents are the calluses for them starting their consulting firms. Now, if you notice, most, if not all, cabinet officials in the White House and federal officials, once their terms are over, they all of them start these consulting firms. And I think this is why they were all taking these classified documents home. And you go back to Henry Kissinger, Polinsky, Brumfeld, all of them, the guy that shot the guy in the face, all of them, they probably got these classified documents in their homes as well. And they started their business. You know, Hubbard wrote a book a few years ago. He said, friends in high places. And he hit on a little bit of the having friends in the White House and how the transformation of information is catalyst for them to start their business or maintain a business.
Well, I mean, I don't want to engage in conspiracy theorists or speculation or conjecture, but I do. Let me take a moment to try to be a little bit informative about the term. And this is, unfortunately, we never have enough time to be fully explicate the real facts. You use the term in the meetings, using the term classified documents as though everything's in one basket, and of course that's not true. There are different kinds of classification. Some the documents that are classified at different levels of secrecy, and not all classified documents are the same as every other classified document. That's number one. Secondly, documents are not all classified for the same reason. They don't all contain state secrets. Sometimes it contains secrets that they want to keep from the people. Like I said before, the Warren Commission on the assassination of Kennedy. Nobody was trying to sell that to a foreign government. They didn't want the people to know what really happened in the assassination. So we had to stop, you know, trying so quick to accept labels that the media puts. Remember, the media is doing it because they need sound bites. They can't explain it fully, and most of them don't understand it. So please let's not continue the mistake of thinking that a classified document is the same as a classified document is the same as a classified document.
Well, I mean, that's your opinion. That might be what you...
That's a fact.
Every time we get on this phone, look, this is what I'm thinking in terms of, if you look at the history of officials who left these White House and those things, they are all started consulting firms.
That's not true.
Hold it, Robert. I think you get a little confused here.
No, I'm not.
Yes, you are, because... How many presidents? These were presidents and vice presidents that were caught with confidential stuff. Not senators, although there may be some. Not congressmen, although there may be some. These are the guys, when they come out, they become lobbyists and start these consulting firms. But these presidents ain't starting those consulting firms. So what are you talking about?
I didn't mention the presidents at first, but
that's you
go back to Clinton. Clinton started a consulting firm.
No, he didn't start.
He did not start a consulting firm.
He had the Clinton Initiative, and that was not a consulting firm.
Then what is that?
That was a world.
They might not call it a consulting firm, but he had to be consulting on something. Come on,
Robert.
Okay, all right.
Robert. Thank you. We got to go on. Yeah, I'll be consulting on something. Got a line open. 410-481-1010. I think this is this Sylvia or Sylvia?
Yes, it's Sylvia. Good morning to everyone.
Sylvia. How are you?
Yeah. Hi. I'm calling to find out, have you read the article in the Baltimore Brew about BGE is quickly pushing to control Baltimore underground conduit system? Have you read that?
Oh, absolutely.
Okay.
Absolutely.
And it's put in there by Mayor Jack Young.
You know the history of that. I don't mean to cut you, but that's a very, very important. I've not only read the Brew article, but I also read the draft agreement to the so-called settlement agreement between the city and BGE, whereby under this draft agreement they would in effect give BGE the same control over the conduit that they would have had, but was prohibited by the vote from the voters back in November.
Mm-hmm.
So they're trying to backdoor it. So the real question is, who's pushing this? Who's pushing this idea that BGE should be given control over the underground conduit system that controls the flow of electrical wiring, telephone wiring,
and other
uses? But primarily BGE, you talk about water bills. You look at your BGE bill. And think about what's going on.
Yes.
If they
yes.
get under control.
Yes. Mine went up this month over $300.
Yeah.
Yes.
Yeah. Yeah. Yeah.
Uh-huh. Yes. And also,
hold on a second.
I'm not cutting you off. Okay. Yeah.
Didn't the people vote against that?
They voted.
Yes.
They voted for
yes.
a charter amendment that will prohibit the sale or mm-hmm. transfer of the system
right.
to BG&E.
Mm-hmm.
So now with the city, they're trying to backdoor it. Now they came up with an amendment. See, that was a settlement agreement between the city and BGE. The city raised the rates, as they should have, to maintain the system. BGE said they raised it illegally under a prior agreement or prior understanding. They settled that lawsuit 3 or 4 years ago. Now they're trying to do an amendment to that settlement agreement, and under the amendment, guess what? They're trying to place in the amendment, give BGE the same controls under the amendment that they would have had if they'd been able to sell it or transfer it, except for the fact that the voters prohibited it. They're trying
Ooh.
To backdoor it, in other words.
Sound like a little...
So, yeah.
Sound like a little doo-doo going
There's
on.
There's some backroom stuff going on.
See, yes,
yeah,
it is.
Yeah.
Because this came up when Mayor Jack Young, when Jack Young was mayor, and he voted against it, and so did Brandon Scott voted against it. Okay.
Then,
now, I'm going to use the word allege, okay?
Then.
I understand that. I understand that BGE donated to Brandon Scott's campaign.
Hmm.
Okay, now, that's the word that I got. But, you know, this is just the people, the citizens of Baltimore is voting against something, and it's just like that council person. They feel they can ignore the vote and handle it their way. But I understand that what is happening there, Brandon Scott is giving it, not selling it, it's giving it to BGE.
Well, we need to stay on that, Silver. Keep us abreast
yes,
on that. We
yes,
need to watch that
do,
very closely.
Please do.
Yeah,
please do.
Yeah.
Please.
Okay.
And Fox 45 already knows about it,
mm-hmm.
so maybe eventually after they do the investigation, they will bring it up.
Okay.
Okay.
All right.
Okay.
Thank you, Silver.
Thank you.
All right.
Oh, you're welcome.
Bye-bye. Okay. We got one line open, 410-481-1010. Mark, you on the air. Mark?
Hey, how y'all doing?
All right.
Yeah, Carl, I gotta get your cell phone, man, because I have a lot of stuff I be getting. But anyway,
just call my number. It'll come into my cell if I'm not home.
Okay, all right. I want to thank Tehma for bringing the folks on the last couple of weeks. Like you said, Carl, no excuses, no excuses.
Ain't no excuses. Nobody got a job, but
and no excuses, and it was good to see you, Attorney Bob, at the Black Men Unifying Black Men Breakfast. I thank you for bringing that to our attention when we were voting about the conduit. That was very, very important. We do got to keep an eye on that. But I agree with you, Carlton, 100%. As somebody that's out in the street, as somebody that's been in the room with pretty much everybody, that is total nonsense. Jill Carter does not speak. You know, they act like they progressives and they helping us out and all that, protecting the children. That couldn't be farther from the truth. You know, because our children are being slaughtered. They crying. I had a young lady. We was out at a town hall. I mean, yeah, out on the grass when City Hall was still closed down. And Pastor PM Smith brought this young lady down, Carlton, and she said, "Where is the where is the metal detector?" She said, "We got kids bringing guns to school, you know, for protection." She said, she had tears in her eyes. She said, "We shouldn't have to pray to turn 18. She said a friend of hers was shot, you know, and they don't have a clue. Kenzie Scott tried to talk to Jill Carter about, you know, what would be going on. And Ivan Bates, he's been to the treatment center. I was with him over at the male school. He's been out in the street with us, and he's hiring more prosecutors. And he told the commissioner straight to his face. He said, "Now," he said, "that I reversed that bill, whether you don't prosecute certain things." He said, "Y'all can go out and enforce the laws that's on the books." He said, "Y'all could have been doing it in the first place," and the commissioner just looked, you know, like he wanted to be somewhere else. So you absolutely 100% right, Carlton. You're 100% right about the mayor Bennett being in over his head. Pastor Smith is 100% right when he said that we gave the keys to the youngest too soon, and we not letting them run us off the cliff. And he was also 100% right when he said Dr. Tyrone Powers, who do work right now, at former FBI, he does work right now, police work. He ain't washed up. He ain't retired and all that kind of stuff. He said, Pastor Smith said that the mayor should have more speed dial. But he was 100% right, caught when he said the criminals are more organized in their chaos than our leadership. Y'all take care. Be blessed.
Hey, Mark.
Yeah.
You on this Sunday or what?
Nah, man. I got Captain Andrew next Sunday. I'm on every other Sunday.
Okay.
Next Sunday, 5 p.m., I got Captain Andrew Muhammad, who's the executive director of WERA.
Okay.
Five
people. All right. Well, listen, because we're going to continue the discussion you just brought up, because I forgot that Bob come in. We were having a talk about that Jill Scott situation right now. We got one line open, 410-481-1010. Go ahead, Bob. We were talking about that Jill Scott situation, and you were about to give your opinion.
It's a delicate, it's a tough balance between the fact that we want to give kids an opportunity, who've been denied a bunch of stuff, we want to give them an opportunity to try to turn their lives around. We don't want to take steps that lock them into permanency in a path that they've taken by choice or otherwise. But at the same time, there's a legitimate need to provide a safe environment for other people, for people in the community and so forth. So there's a balancing act. You can't that's at every level. That's at every age. It's not just youth. It's at the adult level. Everybody who commits crime doesn't get locked up anyway, no matter what your age is. It's just like riding down speeding down the highway. The cop pulls over one, and the other 50 of us keep on going 90 miles an hour because we know he's already taken up. But so Jill, I think, maybe pushes the thing too far in her argument, and many people do. But the fact of the matter is that it is a challenge. There's a great amount of discretion involved, and we have to do a better job of picking the right people and putting the right people in the jobs so that we can trust their judgment.
Tehma?
I think that there's definitely a balancing act that should be done. However, I think the frustration with the city of Baltimore is that when you balance the safety of the community against the rehabilitation of the perpetrator, the rehabilitation of the perpetrator always seems to come first and be more important than the safety of the community. I think first and foremost, once someone commits the crime, regardless of the age, the number one objective is to keep the community safe. That means that the perpetrator should be taken out of the community, whether that's detention, jail, or what have you. And then you work on their rehabilitation once they are outside of the community and the community is safe. We cannot work on their rehabilitation by saying, well, they're too young to get locked up, so we're going to keep them in the community. That's making us not safe, and that's not acceptable. First and foremost should be the safety of the citizens, and if anyone commits a serious crime, regardless of the age, they should be taken out of the community.
Well, Bob, off air, you and I were talking, and you mentioned about the parenting thing, which I wholeheartedly agree with.
Yes, yes.
There needs to be more attention on parents being parents. First of all, they need some parenting courses. Because here's a major problem that I look at it, and my wife does too. She brought it up, I think, when she was on here once, several times before. You now have grandmamas that might be only 48 years old.
Mm-hmm.
Because the grandmama might have had a kid at 16.
Mm-hmm.
That kid she had a kid at 16.
Mm-hmm.
So that means that she now 32.
Right.
And then she had a kid. And in a lot of cases, through generations, it repeats itself.
Right. Right.
So you got babies raising babies.
Right.
And they don't know how to parent.
Well, what I said was about the if a kid shows up with a gun in school, they probably got it from home. They didn't. They probably had it when they left the house in the morning.
Mm-hmm.
They didn't stop. They didn't stop at CVS or Rite Aid or 7-Eleven
and buy a gun.
Right? They had it at home. And more likely, if they got it from home, it probably belonged to the adult living in the household, mm-hmm. or the adult living in the household allowed them to have it on their own in the house. That's who I would punish. That's why. And Tehma said, "Well, what if it's five kids? You'd lock up the parent, then the other four go. With that parent, they were going to end up in foster care one day anyway, unless they were strong enough in their will and their foundation to avoid it. But the fact of the matter is, it's the parent who are, those are the ones who I would lock up, who I would focus on, because that's, you can't, you, we can't teach parenting necessarily, but I do believe that the parents have a desire to stay out of jail.
Right.
And that would be the inducement for them to do some things that they're not doing now.
So would you lock up the parent and the kid, or the parent instead of the kid?
The child will be provided and subjected to whatever treatment is available within the confines that are necessary to successfully, at least reasonably, we think, apply the treatment. Now, that doesn't mean that if it's a minor, minors have to be under somebody's supervision all the time anyway. So whether it's I'm not talking about, the kid doesn't have to be in Hickey school to be under supervision. And the fact that it's not in Hickey school doesn't mean he's running the street wide either.
Mm-hmm.
First of all, we don't have put enough resources in that area.
Right.
And every time we do, and the problem if we have strained resources is that the people with the real money are not in the system. We're trying to figure out how to keep making people who don't have the middle class and the poor people pay for this stuff while the rich people keep going to the bank.
Yeah.
But my question is, what type of supervision? I mean, it's okay.
I don't know.
And I'm just saying, it's okay back in the day when, you know, you had kids doing petty crimes, stealing a candy bar, you know, knocking over a plant or whatever. But now you have juveniles doing burglaries,
carjackings,
murders.
Hello.
So there's no supervision outside of being detained that will qualify to be just.
That is a major problem. That is a major problem. Adults are not taking hold of their kids. You got a lot of households around here where the kids are ruling the household over the adults, which I don't understand. But anyway, we're going to Joe, Elijah, Janet, Carlos, and we got a line open, 410-481-1010. Okay, let's go to Joe. You on the air.
Yeah, good morning, Carlton Douglas, Attorney Tehma, and to Attorney Dashiell, who comes from good stock just like me. let me just say this. You know, I feel like in a way I'm sort of kind of with you, Attorney Dashiell, but let me tell you this. These young people could get a gun fast out in the street than they can get a ham sandwich. Because trust me, there's guns flowing all around. And I mean, there's the percentage is there of those that guns that are coming from home, but it's more out in the street. Because once they get those guns, you'll find out that gun was used for various crimes. You know, there's more of them out there. Now, I agree with you wholeheartedly. These parents need to be held accountable.
Yeah.
These parents, I'm sorry, where I hate to say it like this, but if you look at some of these young people out here in the street, the way they're acting, I guarantee you their mothers and fathers are doing the same thing. So what do they got to look up to? Who do they have to look up to?
Yeah.
Who they have to reach or somebody to say, no, you can do better than this. They don't have nobody. I'll use an example. A new family across from the firehouse up there Junction. Them young boys are out there all day, every day, half of the night. They're not trying to get a job. They're not trying to go to school. They're not trying to better themselves. They're doing the same old thing. And I keep saying to myself, where are their mothers? Where are their fathers? Where's an aunt or uncle? Somebody to go and snatch them up and say, no, you're not going to live like this. And that's our problem. We got to put emphasis on these parents. But it's sad that these, you know, they where they come from. So, again, like I said, my condolences to those young men that got killed this year. I think it's getting ridiculous that, now they're carrying guns. They think they're carrying guns around. If you see some of these young boys hanging out on street corners and you see one or two of them with backpacks on, guarantee you, they're either carrying drugs or they're carrying guns. You all have a good weekend.
You too, Joe.
And I think it's also a generational thing when it comes to the parents. I know when I was growing up, and probably when you were growing up, our parents or whoever was in charge of us, they had like the ultimate authority. You know, we were afraid of them. I mean, we just thought that was the end of the earth. Yeah. You know, if something happens, our parents is going to get us, and then we're really going to be in trouble. Kids these days, and realistically so, they know their parents don't have control. And realistically, parents don't have control. You know, when your kid acts up, what are your options? To ground them. Kids figure that out. Like, oh, she's going to do is ground me. So what kind of authority and punishment can parents legitimately put out on their kids to make them do the right thing? Take, for example, the 16-year-old who was killed outside of Forest Park. his whole family came together. They seem like decent people. It doesn't seem like there are people who would, you know, be happy with their kid going in the wrong direction. But if the kid did, for whatever reason, go in the wrong direction, what could they do? That don't mean that the parents are not upstanding citizens who don't want this for their kid. But at the end of the day, in this world, with all the knowledge that juveniles have, they know that there's really nothing that their parent can do.
Hey, Bob.
Yes, sir.
I know you've talked several times on the show about your father being killed. Right. Am I correct?
That's correct.
How old were you when that happened?
17.
You were 17.
Mm-hmm.
So that means the rest of your life you were reared by one parent.
I was reared all of my life by my grandparents.
Oh, by your grandparents.
My grandparents raised everybody. My mom,
okay.
I never lived with my father. My mother and father were never together during my lifetime.
Okay. Myself, I was raised in a one-parent home, my mother. Although my father and I had a relationship, and he didn't live in the house, but just the mention of my mother calling my father put fear in me, which made me know I'm not going out in that street doing something I ain't got no business doing. First of all, my mother always told me, don't you do nothing out in that street to embarrass me.
Mm-hmm.
Okay. The other thing, my father, just the fear of what he might think or do.
And what was it you were afraid that your father would do to you?
Go upside my head.
That's it. That's what's missing. That is what's missing.
And my mother went upside my head. With no question.
They could do that.
Now, you can do it today.
Now the kids are calling social services nature.
You
I'm
know
just
what?
Saying they know too much. The kids know too much.
Well,
and they you're both
right, because there was a situation I was involved in. A young lady I went with for many years before I got married had a grandson. At the time, he was about 6 years old. His mother, he did something, and his mother straightened him out. This kid got on the phone and called the cops.
Mm-hmm.
The police came and was one of them foolish cops.
Right.
Black cop.
Right.
He comes in, ruling the day like she had completely abused this kid, which she had not.
Right.
They got in an argument, talking about the mother and the cop.
Mm-hmm.
The cop took the kid out of the house, and for that night, that kid had to stay in a foster home. Okay? So you're right on that point, but I tell you what, that kid never did that again because he was scared, you know what, of what he did. He's in a complete environment that he don't know nothing about, and people that love him, he done called the cops on. So you're right.
Carlton, one time with my oldest daughter, I don't remember exactly what she did, but I called her. She said, and I told her I was going to whip her behind. She said, you're abusive, and I'm going to call somebody. I said, you might, but you're not going to do it till I finish whipping your butt.
Hello.
When
hello.
I finish, you can call who you want.
Yeah.
But this minute, you belong to me. And I did. And if they, you know what? If I have to go to jail for discipline for showing my child how much I loved him by disciplining him, then open the cell and lock me up.
And Tehma, I understand where you're coming from, because in this day and age, yeah, these kids are called child protective services, police, and all that. But it depends on how you start out with them from the beginning. If you start out as a stern disciplinarian, they'll get the gist of what they supposed to do. But in a lot of these households now, the kids have taken over. Not the parents.
I agree.
They have taken over. And there's no structure, no parental structure at all.
And there's no reinforcement.
And that's why you got chaos right now.
And there's no reinforcement in the school system.
You're right.
Because they've taken the power
because they took the
power.
Hello.
To impose corporal punishment.
That's right.
And that's what parents in the old days relied. My grandparents relied on that. They couldn't watch me during the day. They were working. But anyway.
And going back to what you say, I completely agree. It depends on how you start off with the kid.
Yeah.
If the parent starts off strict with the kid, then they have time to adjust. And I think that should be the same thing that happens in the juvenile detention center.
Now,
you know, accountability. You need to start off strict with these kids, not just a slap on the wrist, and then by the time they get 18,
and
they have 10 crimes.
And that's what I'm trying to get the gist of what Jill is trying to, get together. I got to hear more about it
because
she's still working on this thing. So we're coming back to the phones. We're coming in this order. Elijah, Janet, Carlos, Ernest, and Gloyd in that order. Okay? Elijah, you're on tonight. There. Elijah.
Good morning. Thanks so much for taking my call, and good day to you all.
Mm-hmm.
I just have a question in regard to the consent decree. What's the status on that? Has it been completed? Has it been signed off on? Or where do we stand on
it? It's still
in force.
Yeah, it's still in force.
It's in force. And what is the projected time for it to be completed? Or
It has no deadline.
Yeah.
It's an ongoing process. And if the city ever wants to be relieved from it, the city has to ask the court for that.
Yeah.
Okay. And regarding to Mosby trial, is there any hint why the defense are releasing themselves or they're not defending her?
No, that's over. The court denied them the motion to withdraw, so that's a moot issue.
Oh, they did?
Yes.
Oh, okay.
When did they make that decision?
Yesterday?
I mean, what's his name? Bolden is still in the case. I don't know about all of them.
Oh.
I don't know. But if he's
Bolden's still in?
Yeah.
Oh, okay. All right.
So they're going to sit and present her, right?
Pardon?
Yeah, they represent her.
And the last thing I want to say, if Biden won, we will lose the election. I think we need to get someone out there right now. Thank you so much.
Okay. All right. Let's go to Janet. And then we got a special guest on the line I'm trying to get to, but I'm going to try to get to Janet and Carlos first. Janet, you're on air.
Hi. I'm talking about those three black cops that killed a black man.
Mm-hmm.
How do you channel that? I saw it first. I can't see that video. And then, how do you channel that? You know, when George Floyd died, I was driving through the streets, blasting my radio with my Bible on the windshield, and the nun who received the rosary, and I'm blasting the, and the neighbors are going, did you see that? Did you see that? I'm so pissed. How do you channel it? It's like they absolutely have to go to jail, but can't channel it. I just can't, you know? I don't even want to see the video. No, but, you know, kind of got it, and I don't know how to even,
yeah, you know? Well, we're just waiting for the video to come out. I want to see it because the way they're describing it, it's just as bad or worse than the Rodney King video. So I'm waiting just to see what's happening. Okay.
And you know, one cop said, I got blood on me, Okay, thank you.
Uh-huh.
Bye.
Carlos, you're on air. Brother Carlos?
Yeah, I'll try to make this real quick. Mm-hmm. Thanks for taking my call. I was asked a couple of weeks ago what was my empirical evidence that the medical EMTs were overboard. And here again in this situation, we have two EMT and the firefighters that are going to be suspended. We don't know what the depth of their involvement in this is yet,
right.
But it continues to unfold. These cops appear to be like the old slave chasers. In other words, the cops come out of the slave chasers. They were chasing down the slaves in early America and so forth, and embedded within those white slave chasers were black slave chasers who were hard to chase down the slaves and so forth. And that's my particular take on that. I'm still waiting on that result. And so forth, and to see what comes out. I have a question for your guests, for your attorneys, mm-hmm. and you can marinate on this and let me know next week what you think about it, whether it's too provocative. in America, by de jure or by law or by de facto, we are considered to be enemies of the state. And the treatment that we have received over the 400 plus years that we have been here. Do you find any credence in that statement? Next week I'll expound on why I've come to this conclusion in my late senior life.
I can answer right now. The answer is no. And not because I don't understand why you came to that. but because the answer presumes that the state and those in control of the state are whenever that we don't have the power to change it. That's the problem. We start off believing that we are powerless, and we're not. I don't like when people use they. Who we are the they. We now know. Let me finish. We now know why Abraham Lincoln was killed 10 days after he started talking about giving the Negro the right to vote. The fact of the matter is, it's the ballot or the bullet. We know that the ballot works. We saw the aftermath of 2020 with all the 22 states where Republican governors and legislators tried to further restrict access to early voting and other measures. Mm-hmm. We know that if we go to the polls, we can change who they are that make the decisions. There's only really one question in the universe, and that is who decides.
Well, it's interesting, and I'll expound on this next week because you don't have time, but you cited Malcolm X, the ballot or the bullet, and I'll come back to Malcolm X next week to undergird what I have my statement.
Thank you, Brother Carlo. Appreciate you. Okay. All right, when we come back to the phones, we're coming to Ernest and Gloyd. We got a couple lines, but we're coming to a special guest, my friend to this show, Coach Butch McAdams. And, Coach, before you get started, there was a situation here we hadn't gotten to. We were going to play, a clip, but the clip is kind of long. But there was a discussion that we were going to talk about concerning Ed Reed after his emotional Bethune-Cookman ouster. But you called in, so you go ahead and say what you got to say, and maybe you can give us a little input on that.
Well, it was a lose-lose situation for both entities. Ed Reed was absolutely correct in what he was saying, but in my opinion, incorrect in how he said it. In other words, Ed has to understand that if he wants to be a coach, then he's got to conduct himself in a very dignified and a mature matter at all times. And while, as I said, I don't have any problems with what he said, it brought light to the lack of having facilities and things and organization and structured and financed to some HBCU sports programs. But you can't go on social media and give a profanity-laced statement as he did. That put him in a bad light. But also, Bethune-Cookman has been placed from an athletic perspective in a bad light. And I'm going to go back to what we talked about months ago about Dion. As I said then, I'll say this morning, I believe that beyond the money offer and the opportunities, that Dion felt in his heart of hearts that he had taken that program as about as far as he could have. And so he was looking for the next chapter. But that's how I see it about Ed Reed. It's unfortunate, but Ed has to have more poise next time.
Okay. Coach, we got about 8 minutes, and I got two people on the line. Now, what was the reason you called in?
I called it real quick because I do agree 100% with attorneys Smith Wilson in that there has to be consequences. I don't know whether you're aware, but a big story over here in D.C. for the last couple weeks, a 13-year-old boy was shot for allegedly trying to rob cars, breaking the cars and steal cars. Okay. And some people say, well, you can't blame the parent. You can't do this. You can't do that. Why not? What is a 13-year-old doing out at 4 o'clock in the morning? Hmm. And I've heard lame excuses about, well, you can't lock the room. You can't put a leash on them because people do sneak out. No. If you've been a parent, no child is going to sneak out at 4 in the morning. And from a legal perspective, the grand jury has it. But the individual, the alleged individual, has not been charged with anything. And guess what? It's unfortunate, but I hope he is not charged because my sources are saying that it could be a case of self-defense. Attorney Tehma Smith-Wilson, give your number again, because I want to contact you, and I want to invite you on my show to interview you.
Yes, thank you, Coach, and I have a question before you leave. My telephone number is 667-334-7242. 667-334-7242.
Okay,
all
right.
My question is, you said that it was a lose-lose for both situations, but I guess the disappointment is that they could not overcome their differences and make it a win-win for both situations. We understand this is Ed's first opportunity, so he's kind of rough around the edges. There's some things he needs to work on, but at the same time, this is Bethune's Cookman's first opportunity to be taken to a certain level in terms of major donors coming to the table to help out their sports program. So why couldn't they make it a win-win for both situations going forward to the future? Because at the end of the day, it's about the kids and the institution.
Well, unfortunately, you have people that, as Mike, Money Mike, I call him, he calls in and talks about just thinking at a higher level. First of all, they should not have announced it until they gave him a contract. Okay, that was the first blunder, in my opinion. Ed Reed was doing press conferences on a handshake, on a verbal agreement, not a contract. Mm-hmm. And you've got to learn how to do business, okay? And just because you're black, people shouldn't support you because of your ethnicity and your skin color. People should support you because you're black and you have a good product.
Well, Coach, I work. Why wasn't Ed's apology sufficient? I understand that the sensitivities and the sensibilities of people who don't like profanity and all that kind of stuff. But that's part of our culture. I'm not making an excuse for it. But he apologized. He said, "I'm sorry," and he said it profoundly, and I think he said it sincerely. Why can't we accept that for one another?
Quickly, Coach, because I have to go.
All right, when you say we, who are you talking about? Institution?
I'm talking about the president of Bethune-Cookman. Why wasn't Ed's apology enough to say, okay,
Because in my opinion, it was not just the profanity, it was what he brought to light, okay? The trash, the incompetence, the lack of professionalism.
On the part of Bethune-Cookman, was that a secret? I thought people walking around the campus saw the trash.
Well, people walking around the campus saw it, but the world didn't see it. The country didn't see it.
Got to go, guys. Okay. Got to go. Thank you, Coach. Appreciate you. All right, quickly. Ernest and Gloyd, you're the last caller. Ernest, quickly, you got 45 seconds. Get it in, please, because I'm up against the clock. Go ahead, Ernest.
No problem. I thought what Coach said in response to your Ms. Tehma's a question about Ed Reed was on spot, but she's got a point. But I don't know. You know, like you said, once it goes out, you know, the word goes out. It's hard to take it back, and you can take the nail out the door, but the scar's still there. But that's why I think it was a lose-lose. Donald Trump and those papers. I thought everybody said he didn't even go to briefings. In my opinion, I don't think Donald Trump really read, so I don't know what he would be doing with classified documents, because I don't think he really reads them. But I can understand people might take them home, because sometimes you can't get everything done at work. And as far as guns go,
you ain't supposed to take them home. You ain't supposed to take them home, but go ahead.
Oh, okay. And thank you, Mr. Dashiell, for letting us know that Mary Mosby still got an attorney. But the gun, a legal gun, is very, very hard to get. I'm trying to get one, and I've been waiting for like 3 months. And when you get your HQL license that you can own a gun, which I finally got, when you go to pick the gun up, then they make you fill out another application that goes to the federal government, and I'm still waiting on that. Because, you know, like I'm saying, so those guns on the street.
Got to go, Ernest. Got to go. You got to call earlier.
Okay. All right.
Okay. 30 seconds, Gloyd. Go ahead.
Hello?
30
Hello?
Seconds.
30 seconds? Oh, man, I can't say all this in 30 seconds.
Well, call next week. Call next week.
No, can you hold me over? Can you hold me over?
No, ain't no hold over. We ain't got another hour.
Oh, man. I'll try to get it out.
All right.
Now, y'all know peer pressure is rough.
Yep.
a lot of these kids are dealing with peer pressure.
Yep.
And I had a problem with when the school started transferring, busing kids into
school. But we got to go, Lord. We understand the peer pressure, but the peer pressure is on us right now. We got to get ready and get out of here. Close it out, Tehma.
Thank you for joining us once again this week. I would like to remind you that the CIAA is coming to Baltimore. So if you have not already purchased your tickets, please purchase your tickets. Come out, support, bring your family. It's February the 20th through February the 26th. If you have any additional information or if you need any additional information from any of the guests that we had on, text me and I'll send you the information, the flyers, that personal contact information. And last but not least, I would like to say happy birthday to Mr. Joshua Taylor. He turned 101 this week. Happy birthday. Hope you have many more.
Happy birthday, Ms. Taylor.
If anyone needs to contact me, I can be reached at 667-334-7242.
Bob?
Today being the first day of the rest of your life, use it wisely. Robert Dashiell, 410-547-8820.
And this has been Carlton Douglas of the Carlton Douglas Funeral Services. If you need our services, the number to call, 410-669-1738, 410-669-1738. Every Friday here on 1010 WOLB from 10 to 12, it's the Frank M. Conaway Sr. NL Show with co-host Attorney Tehma Smith Wilson, Attorney Robert Bob DeShields, and yours truly, Carlton C. Douglas. And I always say, take your head with your ear, put it to the ground, and listen to the grass grow. See ya! Don't want to be. Bye!